Stoat's tail, green butt. She didn't accept the offer from the Queen to receive her award. She had bridge that night, no one to look after her collie. She'd have felt like a fish out of water, away up to London from Brora, with her kilt and hair she'd cropped herself, her father's tweed jacket and men's boots. No one passed remark anymore in Kintradwell, where Megan Boyd had never gone to school, but always worked with her father at the sheep. Megan Boyd taught herself to fly tie. Her father gave her a book, and by the age of 12, she had unwound and rewound and rewound the filaments that made those captivating hooks you tie to a cast to catch salmon on the run. Tail of white silk, turned once, turned twice, turned three times. Body of one third gold, one third silver, one third blue floss. Ivory, gold, pale blue silk, feathers of a white swan, feathers of a blue swan. She could step a gay Gordon or a Highland jig, swing her partner as good as any gilly at the Cayley, and dance through the names. Green Highlander, Stoat's Tail, Woolly Hugger, Durham Ranger, Snowfly, Thunder and Lightning. Of all the fully dressed salmon flies, Green Butt, Silver Doctor, White Lady, red is a nest of salmon roe, fertilized by the milt of the male in the gravel, the eggs to alevin to fry, then par with marks to show their youth, then smoked. Working under a corrugated tin roof, Megan would have no electric light, no television, no telephone, no running water, just the rustling of the sea and the fly in the clump, the next hair, next strand of feather balanced on the end of an open lipstick. A pencil and notebook under the front doormat so customers could scribble an order and she'd make it in her own time. No one knew where she went each Sunday, what pool of shade she lurked in when she'd not be found at home, for she'd not work on the Sabbath. She wouldn't fish. I wouldn't kill a salmon if I got one. I could never do that. But she knew each loch and river, each spate and stretch and current, and when and where and how the wind, the clouds spoke to the water and the silver spawners. She loved most the River Naver, the River Borgie, the River Thurso, the River Brora. Which fly would be best? Like a fearsome adolescence, the smolt getting their mercury sheen in the silty in-between of brackish water, readying themselves for surviving the salt ocean. And they'd never be the same again. Anadromous, freshwater creature, becoming saltwater fish, returning to fresh water, but the body's understanding stays with the sea. Megan knew the swithering and the skite, the both and the neither of it, saltation of the self's becoming what it must, answering to the earth's magnetic will. Most return after a year, the silvery hunters from the ocean, the grilse and the big springers. All that muscled mentness mapping back to their birth river by smells imprinted in the smolt's mind. And the female searching out a settling place, and the male smudging himself against her, and the laying, and the deed completed by the milt, almost without guilt, all outside of the flesh, almost androgynous. They don't feed in fresh water, the salmon. So the lure was a call to something unthought, some needed unheeded, like soul desire, some instinct between colour and pulse, like poetry, or a last taunting chance at the past. The greyness of shrimps in the sea looks black in the deep. The fly she designed is all blacks and blues. We can't see it right ourselves, the Megan Boyd. Blue and black feathers tied to a single hook, or as a tube fly, its size according to the weather. Blue and black in the light, the colour of shrimps in the deep. Her vision went further than any angler's cast, but Megan knew she could no longer tie when she was making the heads of the flies bigger, and she always said any imperfection would alarm the fish when it drifted in the water. Ach, it was worse than a kilt, a salmon after spawning. Most of them die, lying drowned and exposed in the burn that bred them, lying blind-eyed to the horizon's lure. In a nursing home in Golspie, her gulping cry as she lost her sight, and they said it would never return. She lost her rivers, landed for all to see, caudal fin floundering in unbearable air, slow collapse of breathing, frantic inward stare.